very fitting song since we're studying in the book of Zechariah. Zechariah means the Lord remembers. If you've been a longtime veteran of Operation Christmas Child, you'll remember that song because that's our unofficial national anthem fight song of Operation Christmas Child. He knows my name. Aren't you glad God knows your name? About 16 years ago, a man in our church had gone to glory. Called me and told me he just wanted me to be encouraged. He was up at 4:25 in the morning, been up mostly all night, but at 4:25, he said, "I want you to know I've just gone through the whole entire prayer list of the church, and I'm praying for you specifically." And this was after he had received chemo the day before. He'd been throwing his guts up, his own words, most of the night. He was sweating, had fever. He said, "The sweetest time came in the morning when my body felt like it could not give any more. And I was cold and I was fatigued." And he said, "And boy, did I get a message of God that he loves me, that he's still in control. And while you're up, you might as well be praying for other people." That's amazing, isn't it? Dietrich Bonhoeffer. If you know anything about Dietrich Bonhoeffer, you need to get a book called Breakfast with Bonhoeffer. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer was a man who understood what persecution was, being locked up
in the Holocaust of the Nazi concentration camps. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer really became not just a great author, but a very accurate, very well-respected theologian. Bonhoeffer said this: "The times that God spoke to him the most was in his height of despair, at the lowest points of being starved and watching people all around him die. You could smell the death, but," he said, "I knew God was fully alive." It's incredible how God speaks to us in the valley, isn't it? And tonight I want you to take your Bibles and turn to Zechariah chapter 1, because we are talking about finding God's comfort in the valley of trouble. And I want to tell you, if you're not in a storm, you may be coming out of one or you're going to go through one, but if you're not having any problems, please go across the pew tonight or go next door, because you'll find somebody who has lots of problems they'll be glad to share with you. Because there's a lot of burdens, a lot of problems in our lives, isn't there? But God is still on throne. He is still the same God. And tonight I want us to see finding God's comfort in the valley of trouble. And I want us to begin in Zechariah 1, verse 7, because we're going to break this down as we go. "On the 24th day of the 11th month," which is February, this is according, he says, "which is the month Shabbat, in the second year of Darius." Now we know Shabbat is Jewish calendar, February, very significant. And it's significant that God has chosen to reveal this to Zechariah a specific time. They're about 6 months now into the rebuilding of the temple. Now watch this. He says, "The word of the Lord came to Zechariah, the son of Berechiah." The second time we've seen that. Zechariah means the Lord remembers. Berechiah, the Lord blesses. The son of Iddo, the prophet. "I saw by night, and behold, a man riding on a red horse, and it stood among the myrtle trees in the hollow, and behind them were horses, red, sorrel, and white." Now, doesn't that just fire you up to see a vision like that? That sounds like a bad dream, doesn't it? That sounds like you've ate the wrong thing going to bed. And notice what he says: "I saw horses, red, sorrel, and white among myrtle trees." I'm going to tell you, this causes a preacher to do a lot of digging here. How many of you have ever had weird dreams, but nothing like this? And then notice what he says in verse 9. "Then I said, my Lord, what are these?" That's a fair and accurate question, isn't it? Because about 11 times in the book of Zechariah, he's asking God for an explanation. These visions are unbelievable. They're clouded in mystery. But God has a reason to reveal it as such. "And the angel who talked with him said to me, I will show you what they are. And the man who stood among the myrtle trees answered and said, these are the ones whom the Lord has sent to walk to and fro throughout the earth. So they answered the angel of the Lord," by the way, which is Christ himself, an Old Testament appearance, "who stood among the myrtle trees and said, we have walked to and fro throughout the earth, and behold, all the earth is resting quietly." If you're on Facebook, if you're on the internet or anything like that, you will see pictures of a GI or a police officer in uniform or a firefighter, and below that will be the caption, "Sleep well tonight, we're on duty." Have y'all seen that? Isn't that wonderful? Knowing what our officers go through, knowing the horrific events of the past couple of weeks, but they said, you can sleep well tonight. I'm on duty. The soldier, he's on duty, isn't he? The firefighters, they're always a phone call away. First responders, they got our backs. They're on watch and patrol. Well, I want to tell you tonight, God's on patrol, folks. He's walking to and from the earth. He knows exactly what's going on. And we can rest quietly. And this is a nation that is in turmoil. And I want to tell you, you say, well, that's Israel. That's them. That's not us. And you know, Elijah was in a cave and God spoke to him in a very powerful way. But tonight, whatever your valley is, whatever that cave is, whatever that dark time is, whether you caused it or someone else caused it, I want to tell you, rest quietly tonight. God has the earth under His watch care. And it seems like that we look at this world and say, wow, it's completely out of control. What's going to, you know, happening? I want to tell you, I would be real concerned as a Christian, as an American citizen, what's happening in our nation right now. I would be very concerned with the motives, the cursing, the horrific perversion coming out of the mouths of so many Democrats right now trying to destroy this nation from the inside. You say, what about Republicans? Them too. But I'm telling you, the Democrats seem to be stating what they're all about. Why don't they get upset when a police officer dies? Why don't they get upset about the security of America? But they don't do that. And so when we see this, and we see Republicans, they're not doing, you know, they should have stood up. They've had control for a long time. They're as gutless as anyone else. But you know what? My trust isn't going to be in those parties. I know God is on His throne, and He's saying, sleep well tonight. I got your back. I got your back. Officers have a saying, I got your six, isn't it? I got your six. They're watching out for each other. My son has told me numerous times when he's made stops, a big old truck driver will come up and park in front of him just to watch him, just to protect him from oncoming traffic. One of the most dangerous times is when officers have to go on a highway and stop because, you know, the signs move over, slow down. It's the law. People don't pay any attention to that. I've seen school zones become a raceway at 40 miles an hour. I've seen officers stop people in school zones. You don't know how bad I want to stop, brother. Roll my windows down to the person who just got caught speeding and saying, ha, 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 you're going to pay a big fat fine. Because there's no excuse to speed, especially in a school zone. Come on. You know what the flashing lights are for. But they're on patrol. God has everything under His hand. The nations are as a drop in the bucket in the hands of the Lord, is what the Bible tells us. So this is what Zechariah wants us to understand. So notice, where does God comfort His people? In the valley of trouble. Now you notice in verse 8, I saw by night, and behold, a man riding on a red horse, and it stood among the myrtle trees in the hollow. So I want to break this down. What do we mean by the hollow here? The valley. This is where God's comforting His people, in the valley. Now, this fires me up a lot to be able to go into some archaeology, some biblical history, and some background. But I want you to get this hollow, this valley. This is obviously a reference to the Kidron Valley that just runs east outside of the city of Jerusalem. Now, stay with me here just a moment. If you go outside of Jerusalem and you see east of Jerusalem is the Kidron Valley. And across the Kidron Valley is the Mount of Olives. And as you stand there and realize, a lot of history has taken place in the Kidron Valley, because it connects with the Valley of Jezreel. You follow that, it goes to the Valley of Jezreel, which is the Valley of Armageddon, the Valley of Megiddo. And so also remember, Jesus rode up the Kidron Valley in Palm Sunday, coming in victorious into Jerusalem. You need to also remember, in the Old Testament, that's where Asa burned down the poles and the pagan idols of Asherah. And all this, there's a lot of history in the Kidron Valley. But that's where part of this world, the world war, the final war, is going to take place. And so in this hollow, this valley that Israel is all too familiar with, they know it's a site, man. They're tired. They're trying to rebuild the temple. They're trying to get on with what God's told them to do. God said, return to me, I'll return to you. I'm going to bless you, but you've got to keep doing the job that I've called you to do. I've given you the power to endure. But now watch this. In this valley, they're falling over because they know the history. They have yet to know the future and the prophecies of Christ coming in. A lot of them haven't grasped that yet. But do you know that Islam, Judaism, and Christians have built more cemeteries, have buried more people in tombstones and cemeteries right there concentrated in the Kidron Valley? You know why? Because Jesus will come back, going across that valley, into the Mount of Olives. And you know what? Or from the Mount of Olives, standing and going from the Kidron Valley and into Jerusalem, proclaiming his victorious reign and return. But guess what? They built these graves, believing that that gets them a little bit closer to the rapture, the return of Jesus Christ. And so the hollow is a place of depression. It's a place of persecution. It's a place of just pure despair. And I don't know if anybody, as I said, that doesn't go through some kind of a valley. Can you imagine a man being up all night, throwing up, knowing that his days are numbered? And he said, what a sweet time the Lord and I had at 4:25 in the morning. How many of you can look back and say, during this crisis, I had that moment with God where he spoke to my heart and reassured me, it's all going to be okay. I'm looking around at people in here tonight. We've got individuals, our friends from Facebook can't see that. We've got people in this church that have been sitting here tonight that have struggled with the very real possibility of a fatal disease or death, and they're still here, and they're still praising God, and they're still pushing on. And I've seen pews where people have sat, where they've come in with colostomy bags, where they have sat and played the organ knowing they just had a few months to live, where they've come in and served the Lord, and they have visited, and they have done so many things, because they will tell you that God doesn't change in the sickness. He doesn't change in the nighttime, and he doesn't change in the daytime. He's the same God yesterday, today, and forever. That's that sweetness that God is telling us. So let's break this down. And I want you to see Psalm 40, 1 through 3. It's on the screen. But listen, he says, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me and heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay. And he set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. He has put a new song in my mouth, praise to our God. Many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. Now notice this. He says, he brought me up out of a horrible pit. And then we see that this is obviously a cry of someone who's down and despair and discouraged and disillusioned and all the things that you can think of. But then notice what the myrtle trees are. The myrtle trees represent the discouraged people. Now, I don't know that much about myrtle trees. Not like our typical myrtle tree here. All I know is about trees is they shed a lot of leaves. I've got to either mulch them up, rake them up. I know we've got trees along the front of our building, and they block our sign. And we had to have them cut back. When I say block the sign, we have a radio receiver that has to be in light of the sign. It's a whole complicated technology mess. I know that trees are beautiful, and trees are fun to put Christmas lights on. Trees can also be a pain in the neck when you reach up there to grab a branch and there's a wasp nest or something like that up there. Trees can be good, but you know these myrtle trees? They're really a bush. They're not even that pretty over in the Middle East. If they're growing near water, they might flourish a little bit. The myrtle trees, they are not very enduring to the change in climate. The myrtle trees, in verse 8, he says, they are the discouraged people. And then I want you to see the red horse. This is interesting. Now, we put some pictures, hopefully, to get your attention. And I got to tell you, this next one came about a sorrel horse I didn't know, but this red horse, that's the horse of war. And there's scriptures such as Exodus 14, 18 through 9. 2 Samuel 8, 1 through 4, Proverbs 21 through 23, Revelation 19, 11 through 15. The horse was always associated with war, but especially the red horse is a horse of war. This is what Zechariah is seeing. So right now you're seeing a bunch of bushes that look like they're dying. Now you're seeing a red horse in this vision. And by the way, if you called me and said, I had a vision last night, I saw these red horse and a sorrel horse and a white horse, and I saw Oaks Drive Baptist Church, and they look like a bunch of myrtle trees, I'm going to ask the police to come over and search your house to see if you're dealing any kind of drug or whatever you've been drinking. But this is important. The red horse is war. But then the sorrel horse. Now, again, I didn't grow up around horses. My wife did. My wife would have a petting zoo. If she had her dream job, it would be to own a petting zoo. She loves horses and she loves lambs and sheep, and she used to ride in rodeo parades. She's tough. Man, she'll beat you up. She was a goat roperette before goat ropers was even a real term in this world. And she's just a country girl, and she put me on a horse when we were dating. It was Lucifer, that horse, and that horse was dangerous. I've told y'all about this before. I love horses. I don't like to get on a horse because she said, "You tell the horse what to do." I said, "First of all, this horse is blowing snot. Secondly, this horse is in control and taking me where I don't want to go." She said, "Just say, 'Whoa,' pull on the reins." Whoa, that horse looked back at me and said, "Yeah, right." I don't know how many of you are really football fans, but a couple of weeks ago, the University of Texas played the University of Georgia in the Sugar Bowl. Now, I'm going to spare you all the details of who won. It was Texas. But anyways, Texas has a mascot named Bebo. How many of you know what I'm talking about? That's a 3,500-pound steer. And somebody in the stadium thought it was a good idea to have a photo op and carry the Georgia Bulldog mascot that weighs maybe 20 pounds, that little innocent Georgia Bulldog. They took him over to Bebo's makeshift stall, and they were going to get a photo op. And you know what Bebo did? He got ticked off. Now, we didn't know that was a prophecy of how the game was going to turn out. But that little fat bulldog all of a sudden gained a lot of speed. And people were falling. Cameramen were falling out. I was jumping up my recliner going, "Hook him, yeah, baby, right there." We'll teach the Southeastern Conference a thing or two. But nevertheless, I thought, I told my wife before that happened, that's a bad idea. That's a bad idea to put a little dog with a 3,500-pound steer. Who's only 3 years old, by the way. He's still a growing boy. And you know, that was, the odds were stacked. But I want to tell you, this horse, this red horse of war, this sorrel horse is a mixture of color designating the struggle, but also the victory. Because listen, God is a God of war. Did you know that? The Bible says God is a God of war. Does that term make you uncomfortable? Study the book of Revelation. We're doing 5-minute sound bites on the book of Revelation every Thursday night. I'm going to tell you something. We're doing this on Facebook because people need to know Revelation is not for the weak. It's not for the timid. But it is victory for the Christians, isn't it? It's victory for Jesus Christ. He's going to take back what is his. But God is a God of war. And this red horse's war, the sorrel horse, is a mixture of color designating the struggle. And we go through struggles in this world. The Bible tells us in the book of Acts, through many trials and tears and tribulations, we must enter the kingdom of God. The sufferings of this world are not worthy to be compared to the glory which awaits us in Christ Jesus, Romans 8:18 tells us. But so this horse that Zechariah sees is a mixture of color designating the struggle, and a true sorrel horse would have red mostly and a little white on them. But you know, listen, we're in a war. And there's casualties in war. And there's wounds in war. And we go through spiritual wars. And not always do we enter those wars unscathed or come out of them wounded. But with Christ, we do have the victory. But the white horse, oh, that's the horse of victory, isn't it? If you study the Bible, the white horse is the horse of victory. Revelation 6, 1 and 2. Revelation 6, 1 and 2. Follow along. It's on the screen. "Now I saw the Lamb. I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, 'Come and see.' And I looked, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer." Now, who's this rider on the white horse? Who is it? Who's this horse carrying? It's the Lord Jesus Christ, isn't it? Now, watch this. "And I saw heaven open up, behold, a white horse, and him who sat on him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God." This is the white horse that we're seeing and talking about. Now I want you to think about this. Who is Christ declaring war against? Satan and his followers. All those who have rejected him. Who are the people of Zechariah up against? Those who hate God. Those who are opposing the rebuilding of the temple. Those who don't want the walls rebuilt. Those who are saying, let's just have a mixed religion and culture. I want to tell you, folks, the church was never divinely designed by Christ to mix in compromise or worldly principles. The church was established by Christ to be salt and light. Light in the darkness, salt to be a disinfectant, a preservative, to open up the wounds for the sake of cleansing. And then Revelation 19, 11 through 16. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. And out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Notice he's coming on a white horse. So this is what Zechariah has seen, the victory of the rider on the white horse. As I told you this morning, there's no measuring the love of God. There's no valley that can describe the depths of God's love or the reach of His love. There's no one beyond the reach of God's love. There's no one that God cannot love and God cannot save and God cannot redeem. But when we get to this point of a white horse, everything has changed. The love of God is not going to save at this point. The love of God, the holiness of God is consistent with Him declaring judgment upon this world. And then I want you to see something else that's very important. I want you to see how God comforts His people. Look at verse 7, going backwards here just for a moment. In the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came to Zechariah. Now, I've kind of gone a little backwards numerically here, but let me tell you why. The word of the Lord is a very common expression. Repeatedly throughout the Old Testament and throughout the book of Zechariah, the word of the Lord, thus saith the Lord. And when God speaks, we are obviously obligated to listen. You know, when you obey God, you're obeying a direct order. When you disobey God, you're disobeying a direct order. Now, I grew up at a time, you know, growing up in the 60s, and you know, the early 60s, the draft and all that was on. But I can remember even as far back as 1970, at 10 years old, when people were protesting the Vietnam War and people were mistreating our Vietnam veterans horribly, and it was shameful what we did to those, some of the way they were treated in our nation. And God bless our vets, especially our Vietnam vets, who just did not get a fair shake in so many ways. But when we saw them, and I remember seeing the stories of them coming back, and there was not the victory parade, there was not homecomings of sorts and different things. But I want to tell you, though, as I was going through that, I can remember my mom saying something to me in the living room. Because I had sisters, and they were dating guys. I had six sisters. One of them was already married. But y'all remember that term, hippies? Now, don't be offended if you were a hippie. That's your problem, not mine, okay? But some of my sisters had some hippies they were dating. Or at least what I thought were hippies. And they would use terms like the fuzz or pigs or something like that. And I thought that was a cool thing to use until my mom heard me use that term. And Fritz von Erich's iron claw had nothing on this woman. And she taught me really quick what respect really was. And whatever my mom said went. And as I grew up in that era, we were told that if a man or a person of authority gave you an order, you obeyed that order. The principal told you to do something, you did it. You didn't go to the school board and raise a protest. If they told you to cut your hair, you cut your hair. If they told you to wear certain clothes, you wore certain clothes and didn't say, well, I'm offended. I need a safe space to go and meditate for a while on Yogi Berra or whatever it is they do. But you know what? They were in charge. The military guys were in charge. I grew up during that era, and there were people all around me going into the military, and many of them would leave as a hippie. But when they came back, they were clean shaven, and they learned what authority was, and they didn't sleep in on their first week of boot camp. They didn't tell the sergeant, wake me up at 8:30 and let me know when breakfast is. And they didn't tell them when they were going to stop and just quit and do whatever they wanted to do. They were told what to do, when to do it, how to do it. How many of you served in the military? How many of you understand what a direct order really is? When they gave you an order, you didn't say, well, no, I disagree with that. You did what you were told to do. The word of the Lord is a direct order. The source of that order is from God himself, from his throne. The word of God is God breathed through the writers of the Old and the New Testament. God told these imperfect people what to write, how to write it, how to say it, how to express it, right? All scripture is given by the Holy Spirit, inspired by the Holy Spirit. All scripture is God breathed, isn't it? And so this is a direct order, the word of the Lord. And why we want to argue and disagree and say, which part of God's word are we going to obey? That is immaterial. Psalm 119, 49 and 50. Remember the word to your servant, upon which you have caused me to hope. This is my comfort in my affliction, for your word has given me life. This is what Zechariah is finding now among this strange vision of the red horse, the sorrel horse, the white horse, and the myrtles. He is now seeing that the word has been given to him to comfort him in his what? Comfort us in our affliction. Romans 15:4, for whatever things were written for our learning, that we through the patience and the comfort of the scriptures might have hope. Where's our hope at? In the living word, Jesus Christ? In the written word of Jesus Christ, isn't it? This is where our hope is. When I look at the Bible, as I said this morning, I find the hope and the comfort and the direction and the authority in my life. And Zechariah is going through this valley, and this angel of the Lord is none other than a Christophany, an Old Testament appearance of Jesus Christ. And the angel of the Lord tells him in verse 11, listen, we walk to and fro throughout the earth. My eyes are in every place. Rest quietly. Sit comfortably tonight. I'm in control. You see, there's a great thing about our world. We never know when men are really going to take the next step and goof this world up, right? We don't know when we're going to just mess things up. But God does. And he's got a plan for that, doesn't he? He always has had a plan. I can remember hearing when Barack Obama was elected president, I heard preachers say and write, well, that just sped up the rapture. Doesn't speed up. God knows when he's coming back. He's not going to come back based on a presidential election, right? He's not going to come back based on what the Senate or the House does. He's not basing his return and his judgment and his word on Chuck Schumer, Nancy Pelosi, or Mitch McConnell, or Donald Trump. He's basing on who God is. And he is righteous and holy and sovereign and everlasting and all-knowing, all-present, all-powerful. He's eternal God, past, present, and future. And he's telling him, he says, rest quietly. I've got your back tonight. Listen, when I was a kid, and boy, at night, I just did not like to sleep. And I was sometimes scared to go to sleep. Man, we had 5 bedrooms in our house. And sometimes my mom would work late or my sisters wouldn't be home or whatever. And I turn on the TV, and boy, there was nothing like watching Channel U. These young people, if they're hearing this, will not even understand what Channel U is. Channel 59. Remember all those third channel 39 and seeing those old westerns? But y'all remember one of the worst things a kid would see, especially in the summertime watching TV? This test pattern would come on at night. And this big Indian chief's head would show up at night. And then this station was about to sign off. And then you heard the worst sound possible. Oh, man, no more TVs. And then all of a sudden, growing up, I had to do a Sunday night on Labor Day weekend. I could stay up all night and watch TV because Jerry Lewis had a telethon on. And remember, that would go all night long. I loved all night television. Now you can watch TV, you can play DVDs, you can do pay-per-view movies, you can do anything you want to. You can go and get you something. You can get a hamburger at 4 o'clock in the morning. I was in Whataburger the other morning getting an unsweet tea and a low-fat chicken biscuit. But you know what? And it was amazing. Some guy walked in and said, I want a double Whataburger with cheese. It was 6:30 or 6:45, whatever. A hamburger in the morning. You know what? People eat hamburgers for breakfast. More power to them. But, you know, you can do whatever you want now. You've got all this, you know, you're up. You've got all this entertainment. But listen, Christ has always been up all night long. He's always been on the throne. And he's got everything in control. And the great events, what if man messes up tomorrow? What if they do and they're going to? Jesus will come back when Jesus comes back. So what if the Middle East, what if Russia? And what if China get together? And what if Iran and Turkey and the revived Roman Empire all of a sudden come together and start attacking Israel? What if? They're going to find out it's Israel plus one, aren't they? You know who that one is? They're not going to win, are they? Well, what if ISIS comes over here? They're already here in terrorist cells. But you know what? God's already been here. God was well ahead of ISIS. So what if the economy goes bad? It's been bad before. What if we go through another depression? I guess we better learn to farm and garden. Well, what if we lose everything? Well, some of you church members better realize my wife and her are coming to live with y'all. We're just going to rotate every week, you know. What if this happens and what if that happens? God still got the whole world in his hands. Y'all remember that song? He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. That's what he's telling Zechariah. It's a God, it's a book of comfort. Zechariah, remember, I'm in charge. If you, the people, will repent, return to me, I'll return to you. I'll bless you, I'll restore you, I'll give you peace, I'll give you blessing, I'll give you prosperity. The same promise he's been making. In 2 Chronicles 7, he tells an entire nation, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and turn from their evil ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will bless them and heal this land and I will no longer shut up the heavens. It's all about obedience, isn't it? It's all about doing what God says to do. Return to me, I'll return to you. And what's that promise he tells us in James 4? Draw near to me and I'll what? Draw near to you. That's the one thing Satan doesn't want the church to remember. Draw near to me and I'll draw near to you. Because a Christian who is praying, who is obedient, is a mighty weapon in the hands of a holy God. I know guys, some of them are 6 foot four, 250 pounds. I know guys who are 5 foot 11, 160 pounds. I know guys who are 6'7". I've got nephews who are 6'7 and 6'8". I've known guys who are huge, and they're big, and they're strong. And you know what they do? They sign up for martial arts course. They sign up not just for your typical taekwondo or jiu-jitsu, but they sign up for these Bruce Lee type courses. I know guys that have signed up that have been taught by Israeli hand-to-hand combat experts. You want to know if God's blessed Israel? Take on their police force. You'll find out how bad they are. They're well blessed. Israel Air Force, very well advanced. There's a reason for that. But you know what? When these guys are so big and strong and they take these special defense classes, they're even more powerful and they're even more stronger. And they're a weapon because they're armed and equipped with the tools necessary to defend themselves and inflict damage on the enemy. Do you know that when we're obedient to God and we spend time in prayer and spend time in His Word and we spend time in worship, you know, we become a mighty weapon in the hands of a holy God. God doesn't need much, folks. He doesn't need a PhD in theology. He doesn't need someone who knows the Hebrew and the Greek of the Old Testament and New Testament, respectively. All he wants is somebody who makes themselves available to him. And Zechariah saying, Lord, I don't understand what I'm supposed to see. But as soon as Zechariah asked him, God revealed it to him. I'm going to ask you to stand tonight as we go to a time of invitation. As heads are bowed and eyes closed. And understand that in Jesus Christ has always, always been part of the eternal Godhead. He is God, fully Lord. And before he formed you in the womb, the Bible says he knew you. He knows the very number of hairs on your head. And when you lie down and you rise up, our God knows. He sees tomorrow as clearly as he sees this very moment. tonight, whatever valley, hollow, whatever cave that you feel that you're in, our holy righteous God is summoning the call. Obey, trust, don't quit. Tonight, if you never really fully understood what it means to be born again, giving your heart to Jesus Christ, I'll tell you, there's a valley of trouble coming. It's going to start in the Jezreel Valley. It's going to start in the Valley of Megiddo. It's a worldwide trouble. There's no escaping that judgment. So you don't have to be in that valley. The greatest valley is the Valley of Hinnom, the Valley of Hope. Tonight, Christ is willing to save you regardless of where you've been, what you've done. He's willing to pull you out of that miry pit and put your feet on the solid rock. If you don't know Christ tonight, listening by Facebook, in this sanctuary tonight, that's what this invitation's for, is to invite Jesus into your life. To the Christian, so discouraged, so beat down, may feel like a myrtle tree, but there's a white horse coming. And on him who rides that horse is faithful and true. Obedience. Brother Randall sings.